We've seen a lot of amazing stuff. We're going into the ship and we're getting out of here. They get into the ship and going somewhere else. All right. That's where we pick up our lesson. His disciples, verse 16, went down into the sea, going to go to a town called Capernaum. And they're out there on the sea on their way, and Jesus is still in his, this miracle mode of just being Jesus. Because the rules of the earth are there for the natural man. And we have heard how Jesus, it's in the book of Philippians, we've been studying even on some Wednesday nights, how he laid down his heavenly attributes and didn't use them on the earth. But now we see a man, the man Jesus, who discarded all that stuff, not wanting to comply with the laws of the earth in his travels. How many of you got on an airplane and wish that, Lord, I wish I could just keep, they got a flight delay, all of this, 2 or 3 hours behind, sometimes two or three days behind. I've been in the LAX, slept 2 nights on all that hard everything, nothing's comfortable. And so, he ain't too much into taking the normal route that most folks take. So, and why did he do it this way? How can he do it this way? I thought you laid down all your attributes. Here, it says what? And verse 18, his boys out on the ship going where they're going to go. Verse 17 says, it was now dark and Jesus was not come to them. He hadn't caught up with them yet. Verse 18, the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew. Who's blowing that wind? Not Jesus. He ain't trying to disturb his boys out there. So when they had rowed about 5 and 20 or 30 furlongs, I don't know how long that is, they see Jesus walking on the sea. So he's in the miracles. He just did the bread thing. Now he wants to do the walk on the sea. Why did he do that? I thought you laid down your attributes. How could you do that? Any Bible student want to answer? I thought you laid down those attributes and you down here as a man. We never seen a man walk the sea. How are you defining the laws of the earth? How are you doing that? Come on in. We got one more seat over here. That's a quarter. Cost a quarter. 50 cents if you bring one. Anybody? Any challenges? Any commentary? How are you doing this?
Well, we have to show them that he was just more than a common man. That he wasn't just a natural man. You know, he was a natural man, but he was more than just a common man. He made them to understand that he wasn't there to be the king, but he was more than that. He was trying to show them that he was more than that without revealing, who he really was.
Okay.
Because as long as he was just going about praying and doing stuff like that, they were only looking at him as not a savior, but somebody that was going to deliver them out of their bondage. So he had to do something every once in a while to show them that he was more than that without revealing everything. Otherwise, they're just going to keep him in that, you're going to be our king. Okay. Yeah, he's showing them that he was more than what they...
Now, him stepping out doing these things made them want him even more. Yes, you do that true. Amazing stuff. Hey, you said you ain't going to be king. You look like somebody to me. Come back here.
Well, do you think that the reason why he did those, like he stepped out on the water and walked on the water to show them that I am man, but my Father sent me.
Oh,
and by the faith that I have in my Father, I can do these things. And if you believe in my Father, like I believe in my Father, you can do these things also.
Right.
So by him walking on the water and let them know, okay, He's the man. He's walking on water. Mm-hmm. Now, if we believe the way he believed, we can do this.
Okay.
He's trying to get them from thinking that he's a king.
Okay.
Yeah, but they already, he's a fed up now. You know, he got the confidence. Right. Yeah.
He's letting them know that I'm phenomenal.
Yeah.
That's for sure. I'm phenomenal. But I'm not, I'm a man down here on the earth. And I'm a man making bread, doing miracles. I'm a man walking on water, defying the law, because a God can't come down here on the earth and do that. It's illegal. It's illegal for a God to come down here on earth and do what Jesus is doing. It's a strong word, boy. It's illegal. It's only one small G-O-D of this world that can do that, because the first little G-O-D of this world turned it over to the wrong little G-O-D of this world. And the wrong little G-O-D of this world caused that wind to blow. But the other G-O-D, how many heard in the Bible the second Adam? So Jesus is the second Adam. The first Adam could do all that you see this Jesus doing on the earth. He could do that. Ain't no Adam could do that. Adam couldn't do that. What you see the second Adam doing, the first Adam could do, it was doing. But the second Adam, which is Jesus, he says, that little G-O-D that the first Adam sold out to is making the wind blow. But I'm the second Adam, and I'm not controlled by that guy that he sold out to. Complicated way to say it, but Jesus, the second Adam, could walk on this earth and not be controlled by the authority of the earth, because the first Adam was given authority over the earth. He could do whatever he wanted to do, whatever he wanted to do, however he wanted to do. Boom. First Adam. Second Adam, Jesus, can do it on the earth. How could he do that? Qualification number one. Okay. Without sin. He was a man without sin. Sin messes up everything. So all the other guys that was on the earth between the first Adam and the last Adam, which was Jesus, the last Adam, all those other guys between them had a problem. What was the problem?
Sin.
Sin. It's tainted by sin. I should have looked that up. It's in the book of Romans. Probably in the first six chapters of Romans. You're going to see that the first Adam could do whatever, however, whenever he wanted. Because it was given to him in the book of what? Genesis. In the first three chapters. That first Adam could do whatever he wanted to do, however he wanted to do. Whatever you call it, Adam, whatever you do, Adam, it's okay with me. It's you, but you do it. Earth, I'm turning it all over to you. Earth. It's off a lesson about God. We need to see that. The earth is yours, Adam. Do what you want to do with it. How many have heard in the scripture? The heavens are God's, but the earth has he given to who? Man. So Jesus could do whatever he wanted to do as the second Adam, because he had no sin prohibiting him messing with it. So a man without sin, right standing with God, can do whatever he wants to do on the earth. Smack up the music last day. That's how he did it. No sin. Had no sin. Somewhere in the Bible it says, yet without what?
Sin.
He had no sin issues to deal with. Woo! So he could do it. Not as God, but as who? Man. Man with no sin issues. Woo! I think about how I could have been if I had never found out about the PA.
About what?
PA. Yeah, been there. All the red bells. I've been like 16 to 17 years old, never walked down the street and saw those clubs, never went in there. What life would it be like without those sin issues in my life?
You're going to pack in the bed.
So I had to come from condemnation to forgiveness and righteousness to get my mind renewed to figure out who I was on this earth. But until I did, until we do, the sin nature, condemnation, is going to keep you from expiring or reaching your potential. And that's his purpose, to keep you from getting it. That's why the Bible says, oh, I'm getting so far off the lesson that if our heart does not condemn us, if the devil can't condemn you with whatever your past was, man, you got a clear shot here. We have the confidence. Whatever we ask, whatever we want, we got it. Boom. That's how this guy did here. He said, hey, I want to go down there to Capernaum, and I ain't got time to catch the bus. I just walk in the water. Amazing. Well, I got to get donuts and coffee after all of that. We got a lesson here. So that's how he did it when he did here.
Romans 5.
What does it say there?
Nevertheless, death
reigned
from Adam to Moses.
Yeah, something like that. Go ahead and read that real quick if you got it.
Romans 5:14.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many.
You go back and when you started, that first man could do it. The second Adam could do it. So what do we mean by that? First Adam came into the world without sin. Was there ever anybody else in the world that came into the world without sin? Jesus, that's the second Adam, the second like Adam. And then, as soon as I get the revelation that I came into the world like Adam, but something messed me up. Now, I got to find somebody to fix me, which was who? Jesus. But the first Adam, first man came into the world without sin. He could do whatever he wanted to do, however he wanted to do, whatever God told him. It's right there in your
door. We back up to verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world.
Yeah, one man sin came because of one man messed up, Adam. Sold out to sin. Anybody else ever come into this world without sin? Jesus. Oh, the second one, like Adam. So you can do what he wants. They didn't know Brother Williams that he was like that first Adam without sin. He can do whatever he wanted to do, whatever he wanted to do it. Wheat ain't no problem. I make a whole lot of bread out of wheat. Just don't feel like eating it all. Oh, I'm glad y'all here. Here, have some wheat. Bread. You get all the bread you want. Fish, anything I say, got to do what I say. Fish, jump out of the sea, feed everybody. Fish, multiply, feed the whole crowd. That's what he was like. That's what he could do. And that's when sometimes he wanted to show who he was. Show what he was about. I could do all of this, man. Okay, now he says, the boys catch him walking on water. Who would be afraid of that? Yo, what is this? Is that what we are now over there, what we were doing with John? John, what, six?
Yes.
6 and 20, he said to him, don't be scared. Something I feel like you're walking on water. And they received him into the ship. We're trying to get to our story. Verse 23, we're trying to get there because we got to catch it in bucket at 22. That's where our lesson started. The next day, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save that one whereunto his disciples got in, Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples was gone away alone. We saw them leave. He didn't get in that boat. We saw it. Then howbeit there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place that they did eat all that bread that Jesus had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, not his disciples either. They also took shipping. So where'd they go? Well, they went down to Capernaum. That word candy messed up. Yeah, that's town candy. What a mess on the map. Looking for Jesus. So we know he went to Capernaum. Whatever they want to call it, whatever that sister in the 21st century calls it, we're going to go there. So they went there, and we know he went to Capernaum. They're on their way to find him. All right? When they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, what did they say unto him? We counted the boats. And they all still there except for the one your boys left. How'd you get here? Now see, that's what we have. Once we get to who we are in Christ and forgiven and in right standing with the Father God, people are going to ask you, how'd you do that? How'd you do that? How'd you do that? How'd you overcome that? How'd you do that? Because sin is not in the way anymore. It's not the issue. You are who you were made to be. And sometimes you're going to ask yourself, I don't know how I do that. How'd I do that? My spirit said to my mind said to my body, and it was done. That's how it go. That's how it go. Y'all believe it? Go to sleep. Take a nap. See what your spirit get the message with your mind. Throwing you some seeds of possibilities. Do it this way. Ideas. That's another subject, but let's say here. Okay. All right. Verse 26, moving right along. What happened there? Someone help me out.
Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me, not because you see the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled.
All right. There's two things we got to understand about this particular verse. Number 26, really, where it says, verily, verily. What does that mean? How much importance should we put on it?
This is the truth.
This is the truth. This is the absolute truth. In other words, you need to pay attention. I'm telling you something right now. Don't miss this. That's what Jesus is telling. This is a nugget. Don't miss this. If you ever heard me say anything before, but listen right now. That's what he said. He said that several times. I give you the scriptures. In our lesson, verse 26, verse 32, verse 47, verse 53. Go ahead and read 32, sister, since we're moving that way, but go ahead. Who said that?
And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven.
All right.
But my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven.
All right. That's another verse. Listen, you said you better listen up and get some understanding. That's what he's trying to say. Oh, here's a clue. Get this. So, once again, we're back in verse 26, right? I mean, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. wait a minute. Is that right?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, 26. Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me, so why are you looking for me? What you want? A miracle. Another one. Just another one. Just do whatever you do, man. You're pretty good. Just do whatever you do. We don't know how you got here. You fed us all that bread. Your boy said you're walking on water. Okay, let's see. What do you want, man? What do you want for me? New house. New house. Get me a new house. That's what they wanted. New job. Get me a new job, Jesus. They wanted personal fulfillment in life. Who doesn't want that? You want a good house, good car, good wife, good husband, good kids. Give me all the good stuff, man. You know, it ain't no problem for you. Lay it out here. I'm waiting. Arms wide open. And how many know people see? Come to church. Come to prayer. Evangelize. Do everything so they can get the good stuff. What do you say, Sister Jill? Say it because I can get the good stuff. And that's what he said. Is that what he said? Someone read that again. I'll sit down.
And Jesus answered them and said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracle, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled."
All right. Ooh, what an indictment. That's why you hanging around. Does he really make a mistake? No, Jesus pretty much, he says, "Verily, verily," so you better listen. If you ever listen, listen now. This is why people follow me.
Some prosperity message is wrong.
I don't want the big house, big car, the big job, the big everything, the good everything. I want all the goods, man. That's why I'm hustling behind you. Where you go? How'd you get over here? We're following you. How'd you get here? Man, that's how I'm keeping up with you. Man. We're trying to make you king. You all over the place.
But he was telling them he wanted it without working for it.
Yeah. And most of the church folks follow him because of the good life. I ain't following you if you're going to take me into some trouble, man. Make things hard for me. Get me fired. Make me broke. I ain't following you for that. I didn't sign up for that. Hold up before you leave out here. Wow. So he says, so that's why you're following me.
Well, you don't have to put out any money and you don't have to work for it.
Alright.
Well, you know, he's telling them that they're following him for what they see and not for what they don't see.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Alright.
You know, what they don't see is what he wants them to get.
Mm-hmm.
But they can't see that. They just see what he's doing. Mm-hmm. And that's all it means to them.
That's right, bro. Verse 27. We get there?
We're
moving right along. I'm
going to
read that if you will.
Who
got that?
Labor not for the man which persists.
Which perish?
Which perish. Uh-huh. But for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life.
Okay.
Which the Son of God shall give unto you.
Mm-hmm.
For him hath God the Father sealed.
All right. So all right. So labor for prosperity could be a mistake. Laboring for the good stuff that life can bring you. Laboring, that's your number one priority. Get up in the morning, seeking after the good stuff, the good life, the best of the best. I'm getting up running after it. Won't see you again until 5 o'clock, and if I got to keep going, maybe 8, 9, maybe not over the whole week. Running hard for the good life, for the good stuff. So, he said here, and many people are going to take this out of context, but he says, labor not for the stuff that's going to do what?
Perish.
You can identify it. Even a brand new spanking house is subject to what?
Perish.
Car, money, you name it, is subject to decay and be gone. Which is that stuff that can be here for a little while and be gone. Don't put your eggs in that basket. Woo!
All
right. I think it's 6:38 somewhere, he says. But I think it's Matthew 6:38. The kingdom of... Yeah, seek you first.
Matthew 6:33.
Almost annoying. Catch that one. Seek ye first
the kingdom of God.
Is that what it's saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. Seek ye first the kingdom. Is that what it says there? I didn't turn to it. Okay. Okay. So, all right. So, and now if I look at my lesson, it says, labor not for the stuff that's going to perish. Don't make that your priority, getting up and running after that stuff. Make that not your priority. Yes, it's important, but it's not the top priority. Okay? 27, labor not for the meat which is going to go away, but for that meat which endures, lasts, and it'll take you even into eternal life. So, Jesus, what I want you to give to me while I'm here on the earth that's going to take me into everlasting life. That's what I want to know from you. That's what I want from you. I want you to give me something that's going to last here on the earth and then transition me into everlasting life. All right, let's figure this out. How am I going to do that? How am I going to do that? I got to work. I got to show some merits. I got to earn something so I can get enough of that Jesus down here to transition me into that eternal life. No, can't work it. Sorry. There's no marks. There's no work of work you can present to him up there to show that I deserve everlasting life. What? And how am I going to do it? Because that's what they asked me in verse 28. How are we going to do that? How are we going to do that?
Well, that's what Matthew 6 and 7 3. That's how you do it.
How are we going to do it?
It's your purpose.
And the key in verse 28, that we might work the works of God. That we might work the works of God. Now, Jesus is going to give you an answer, because many folks have definitely got the works identified completely wrong. Uh-oh. Write that down. Quote from Williams. We have identified the work completely wrong. All right. Someone, and Jesus answered, and he identified what the work is. What is the work?
Believe on him.
Believe on him.
That's all the work I got to do?
That's
all
the work.
Is that all the work?
Well, if you believe in him, then you're going to do his work.
But what is the work?
Believe, changing your mind.
Believe on him. Yeah. Believe on him. That's it. Wow. Get into heaven? Is that all it took? Yeah. Believe on him. Believe. The same believe is the same believe that's in Romans 10, 9, and 10. Have faith in him whom God has sent. Have enough faith, strong enough in your heart to say it with your mouth. Now, see, believing, when we say that we believe in Jesus, and many people say that, they believe in Easter Stir, so they show up once a year on Easter Sunday, and that's their belief. Something happens between that time and the Easter Sunday, they ain't no, it's weak as can be. But believe means with all of my being. With all of my being, I believe that God sent you, and you died, and you rose from the dead. That's with all of my being, that's what I believe. That is the work. And you better believe it's some effort. It's some mustard on the bread, if you can say that. Because when the yogurt hits the fan, that's what you got to muster up. Woo! The enemy's got a gun to my head. What do you believe? Isaiah 53. Are you believing this? See, when life threatens you with right there in front of you. Here it is. We're on the line with this. You got to believe, I don't care how much medicine, how much money, how much whatever, you got to find it. I believe that he did all this for me to even get by this situation. That's what makes the difference. That's the work. That is the work. You can't be in that hospital bed thinking, you know what, I made it every Tuesday night, every Tuesday morning. I made it every Wednesday. I gave it all the time. I gave all the gift. I did all of this. I did all of that. And here I am laying up here sick, or whatever circumstance of life cut me in the face. I'm going to go look at my work. Good God, right there. Oops. What you say? You say that? Yeah. You look at your work, you're going to die. You're going to lose. What you going to believe? What he said. That he is the Son of God, and that what he did for me, it counts. It counts. What he did, it counts. That's the only thing you got. Oh, I knew it wasn't going to be. Okay. So you got to believe that. Okay. This is the work of God, but you believe on him. What? Him. That you believe. This is the work. Now, anything else that you believe after the work, more power to you. But this is what you got to believe on what he did. And they said unto him, well, since you say that you him, prove it. Prove that you deserve my belief. Prove it. Show us something then. Our fathers, they said, we'll show you something. It's written. You can't dispute this. Our fathers ate manna in where? The desert. It's written in the word. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. And Jesus said unto them, catch a clue. Here's reality. Get this. Let the light bulb come on. You think Moses fed you. You thought it was the prophet. You thought it's the preacher. Yeah, he said, so you think it's the preacher, Moses, that gave you bread from heaven? He says, but what? My father gives you the what? True bread from heaven. He said, I ain't the spirit that you ate bread in the wilderness. But I'm going to tell you this right now. Moses didn't cause that bread to come down. And Moses didn't feed you. God would do it without Moses if he wanted to. He said, now you better believe this. If you want true living bread, substance from here on out, you better eat of the Son of God. And that means you got to let him get his reality get into your spirit, your soul, and your body. If you want to exist down here, otherwise you're going to get beat to death. Spirit, your soul, and your body, you better take that Jesus into you.
Ooh. Well, it seems amazing, though, that every time they see a miracle, right after that, it's always a questioning
I thought he was just...
I just saw you fed all these people.
It's good enough. See, on earth, it's good enough to have a nice, comfortable house, comfortable car, ride, wonderful wife, family. Well, folks, that's good enough. How do you get that? Go to church. Find you a good wife. Find out how to get a job, keep a job. Find out how to eat and all that. Go there and get the good life instilled into you. Well, my folks follow him, but they haven't bought food. Jesus. And when the yogurt hits the fan, when life hits you in the head, you better be able to find that this is what I believe that he did for me. I am not looking at my works, what I have done, where I have been, nothing. You look at your works, you're going to die, you're going to lose. Maybe preachers don't preach it like that. Okay, here we go. My father giveth you the what? The true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down. The substance of God is he that came down from heaven and giveth life unto the what? The world. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us what? But give us this bread. And someone help me out there.
And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. Mm-hmm. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst.
You're not going to lack anything. I ain't going to say that the wind ain't going to lack. I'm just stick out this little G-O-D over here. He's going to flow. But Jesus said, I'm walking on it. We just got time to go on with this. Vern said the little OG ain't gonna do his thing, but you are the second Adam. And you can walk on the water, get there quicker if you believe.
Do you think that's what his whole point was when he did those miracles, such as walking on the water and stuff, was to let them know, okay, I am the Son of God. I believe this is what my Father and Savior do. Mm-hmm. If you believe, mm-hmm. you can do these things. You know.
Hallelujah.
Because most men, you know, it's like Peter. He told Peter, Peter walked out there.
Yeah.
He was watching, he was,
So he forgot what kind of man he was. That's what I think James saying, till you forget what kind of man you are, then you fall back into that stuff.
Well, Mark tells us we do even greater things.
Even greater. You forget, so, whoa, I'm a second Adam. What was the first one like? No sin issues. No sin, short circuit him, no kind of way. Second Adam, that's me. Well, the earth is yours. God gave it to you. You do what you want to do with it. You call it out, you name it, you do it. It's yours. As long as there's no sin issue. Whoa. And if there is a sin issue, knucklehead, go to what? First John. Don't live with it. Don't let them beat you up with it. You say, okay, now we'll take care of it. Second Adam again. Call the things that be not what? Oh, that's second Adam. Until you forget who you are in Christ. Well, I'm going to check out how many times I made it to Bible study, how many days I showed up, how much money I gave. I gave more than Shirley. I'm all right. You're going to die. You're going to lose right there. None of that counts. Whoa, no, don't count. If you want life, don't count.
All right.
I'm never gonna rely on it. I gave the jam, I don't know how much I gave. I don't know. How much you got? I don't know. Well, all I know, once I was blind,
I see.
That's all I'm talking about. I don't know nothing but that. Mm-hmm. Paul says, I don't know nothing but Jesus. That's what Paul said. I don't know nothing but Jesus.
He said, I could boast, but...
I could talk about my stuff, you know? But no, I don't know. I count that as nothing, man. That's done. All I know is Jesus. That's all that counts. Okay, folks, we gotta get out.